Machine learning delivers the predictive intelligence businesses need to stay competitive. Still, many companies struggle to adopt machine learning solutions when data scientists and data engineers face tedious tasks, slow training, and complex deployment. Azure Machine Learning removes those barriers, accelerating the machine learning lifecycle from end to end. As an open platform with automated machine learning and built-in DevOps, you can unlock insights anywhere and easily scale from cloud to edge. New to machine learning? Get started without coding. The powerful drag-and-drop interface lets you go from idea to deployment in a few clicks with no additional setup required. Cut down on manual, repetitive tasks with automated machine learning that enables faster and smarter model prototyping and development. Automated machine learning handles the intensive feature engineering, algorithm selection, and hyperparameter tuning so you don't have to. Out-of-the-box support for many open-source frameworks delivers compatibility for your favorite notebooks, integrated development environments, and command-line interfaces. Stick with what you already know and use your own set of R or Python tools. Build pipelines that let you easily share end-to-end data science experiments and optimize workflows. Boost productivity and speed up solution deployment with built-in DevOps for machine learning. And ensure your model quality automatically improves over time with integrated CI/CD. Supported by an enterprise-grade platform, your team can innovate freely with the scale and security of Azure. Take your results to the next level using deep integration with many other Microsoft services. Tap into smarter machine learning to build a more intelligent business. Create a free Azure account to launch your first workspace and accelerate your path to production today.
Hey everybody, welcome back, welcome back, welcome back. It's Azure Fun Bites. My name is Jay Gordon. I am your host. And what do we do every week? We get together. We have a conversation about all the different interesting parts and pieces and services and complementary products and you name it that make up your Microsoft Azure experience. So I come to you today from the glorious borough of Brooklyn, New York, where we've had quite possibly the most incredible day I could imagine in quite a while. The weather is gorgeous. We got to spend some time, my dog and I, running around, having fun. And I'm going to have some fun today. In order to have that fun, I need help. I'm going to be honest with you. Sometimes I need help having a good time. I love talking to people. And so one of the people that I am actually going to bring in is none other than Hank Bowman. Hey, Hank, how are you?
Hello, everyone. I'm doing well.
And so Hank is, like myself, a cloud advocate with the Azure team. His focus is a little different than mine. He's focused on things like AI, machine learning, cognitive services, and how all these kind of come together and make better apps. Did I get that right, Hank?
You got it absolutely right, yes. And my focus is really on how developers or ops or other people can get started with Azure Machine Learning, to show them the tools we have, to show them that it is not a big science to do it. I think that is what we're going to see today also.
I think so that you're going to give me also, because I'll be honest with you, Hank, I don't really know a ton about machine learning. I just really haven't implemented it in any way. And so you're going to kind of give me some practical use cases on how I could actually take it and start working with these services that are built into Azure that also integrate with other really like critical core services. I know we may talk some Kubernetes here, all those things. And I think that little pre-roll video that we played, I just wanted everybody to kind of get an idea of what it is we're talking about. I think it really laid a foundation, and so Hank, one of the things that I've always thought of, like machine learning and AI, to me as a person that was like with a database company for a little while, I always looked at it as like one giant database search. Do I have that right or wrong?
It is one way of looking at. But yeah, I'm a developer, so I mm-hmm. looked from always from a developer's perspective, and maybe you can see it like as if you as a developer you would write a function,
mm-hmm.
like just something in, the magic happens and something comes out. And with machine learning, especially the problem we're going to look today at, we put in an image. The AI is going to look mm-hmm. at that image and will tell us what is on the image. But instead of programming that function, we're going to put that image in. We are actually going to use machine learning to generate that function for us. So
gotcha.
It is like this. Sometimes if I have like one image of a cat and the cat would always be this in the same position on the image, I could actually do it by programming. I would look up the pixels and say, if this is an ear and this is an ear, then it is probably a cat. But it becomes a little bit more difficult if it is a cat or a dog. So maybe I can still do that, figure out something smart. But then we add more and more and more and more, and it becomes almost impossible. Our if statement becomes way too big. And that is actually where machine learning comes in and will generate that function for us. So for this problem, there are many different types of machine learning. There are many types of machine learning and in the AI space where I don't know anything about. But for this problem, you can see it as a function. It's very easy. And you have to write software around it to actually use the function. So that is what we're going to.
Great. So I want to remind everybody, like we do every week, we've got a poll. It's up. And right now I want to know, and you can, you know, join us on our poll. If you go over to aka.ms/learnTV, I'm asking, have you integrated machine learning into your applications yet? If you have, you know, let me know. If you haven't, you know, say no. But if you really want to, You found the right show to be watching, because we're going to start talking about how you can actually do that. And so please go ahead, leave your comments, leave your questions, put them in the chat. It's important that we hear from you, because you may not really understand everything. You may have something that you want a specific answer on. We're here to help you out with that. And so, Hank, I'm going to kind of remind everybody what exactly machine learning is and how it works. Machine learning is the process of using mathematical models of data to help computers learn without direct instruction. It's considered a subset of AI, and machine learning uses algorithms to identify patterns within data, and those patterns are used to create a data model that can make predictions with increased data and experience. The results of the machine learning are more active, much like how humans improve with more practice. And you know what? I was talking to Amy a little bit yesterday on Hello World, which was our lead-in. Thank you, Hello World, for our lead-in. And the thing that I said to her is that, from what I understand, a model is kind of like a combination of the data and a program. They're kind of together. And they work in tandem to be able to provide you information. Can you tell me, am I kind of on the right page what a model is? I know you're going to go way deeper into it, but that's my thousand foot, you know, thought about it.
Yeah, it kind of saves the things it learned from the data.
Okay.
So it doesn't save all the data, because otherwise our models will be way too big.
Sure.
Because if we use gigabytes and gigabytes of data to train our models, then our model would also be gigabytes big. So it saves those insights of models, of the data.
Gotcha. Very, very cool. So I think today we're going to want everyone, as usual, to follow along, see what we've got. There's a lot of great information that we're going to be sharing. And so, like I said, just send your comments, your questions in the chat. We're going to find out a little bit more. But Hank, I know you're going to show me a little something about how to get started. You want to start running with that now?
Yes, we can do that. Perfect, my slides are up. Let's get started with Azure Machine Learning. So today we are going to talk about machine learning on Azure, and then we are going to build a Llama Cat classification model using Azure Machine Learning. So we're going to build it from scratch and then actually have the model up and running as an API in a Kubernetes cluster. And for that, we already kind of touched it on like a little bit. So what is machine learning anyway? So I mostly use this short description and not a long description because I simply can't really remember it. But machine learning is the ability to learn the computer things without explicitly programming it. And this graph made by our colleague Seth Hoyers actually really explains it, how it works. So in the old days, as a programmer, I would create an algorithm function, and I would run data through it, and I would get an answer. This is true, this is a cat, this is a dog, this is a llama. But with machine learning, that is actually switched. So instead of creating the algorithm ourselves, we give a machine learning framework a bunch of answers, a lot of data, and it will generate this algorithm for us. In the machine learning world, this algorithm is called a model. And when we have that model, we can run new data through it, and we will get a prediction. So you already probably hear the difference. Before we got an answer, and now we get a prediction. So your model is almost never like 100% sure.
So your model's kind of like asking questions of your data, essentially. Am I kind of right? Like it's asking questions and then providing answers so that you could do predictions for future answers?
Yeah, so with the classification model, it's going to look like, oh, I'm like, does it fit in this bucket? Is it like more like a llama or more like a cat? So I'm like 99% sure that this is a cat and 1% sure that this is a llama. So that is how it will do. And then you'll obviously pick like, oh, 99%. Okay, that answer is good enough for me to assume that it is a llama. But it can also say like it's 50% a llama. And then in your code, you can determine like, yeah, 50% is not enough for me. And you would just say, I don't know. So to move on to machine learning on Azure, it's a little bit of an older slide, but I really love the slide because it just makes clear what is out there and how it is layered. So first, there are the sophisticated pre-trained models. I really like that word. These are our cognitive services, and these are models created and maintained by Microsoft. So Microsoft has done all the training, all the maintenance, making it fast, making them accurate, and expose them to you through an API. So from a
Okay.
development perspective, you can have a vision model in your application by just calling an API. You can have translation services without training your own model by just sending a text string to an API, and you get the translation back. And these services are really great because you can actually have AI in your application without doing the work. And this is really good if you want to actually prove like a business case. And in my experience, mostly these services will solve like 80% of your problems. So if you want to move forward and you have a really hard problem you want to solve or a very complex problem, you need to start training your own models. Or if you want to train a model based on your own data, so then you need a framework to train that in. So we have PyTorch, TensorFlow, Keras, Onyx. These are all different kind of frameworks that help you create your model. So what you're basically doing is you're using PyTorch to create your model. And to do that, we have services in Azure that will make it a lot easier. So we have Azure Databricks that really helps you with sorting your data. We have Azure Machine Learning, which we're going to dive in, but that service can really manage the whole end-to-end process of training a model, from having your data all the way up to managing your models running in a production service. There are machine learning virtual machines. And these machine learning virtual machines are really great if you want to get started or if you just want to do something quickly, because it takes a lot of time to actually get your environment up and running. And because you need to write, in my case, Python versions, framework versions, your CUDA drivers, maybe you don't even have a GPU. So by just a click, wait 5 minutes, you have a data science virtual machine up and ready with all the tools installed, and you have access to the GPUs that are available in Azure. Then, if we go a layer deeper, we have a lot of infrastructure. Mm-hmm. So if you want to train your model on CPUs, GPUs, it is all there. Azure Machine Learning can help you spin up a GPU cluster and scale it down if you don't need it, scale it up to like 8 GPUs, 10 GPUs, depending on your needs. And finally, we can actually help you deploy these models. We can just give you the model, so you can run it on-prem or in your applications, but we can also help you deploy it in the cloud and even help you deliver those models on the edge using IoT Edge.
So very, this, very cool.
So this kind of shows you all the different like kind of stages you can move in. But I highly recommend that you start out, if you still want to learn what AI actually can do for you and which problems it can solve, to go into the 40 cognitive services that are out there. Bringing me to these cognitive services. So cognitive services are pre-trained models in the cloud and on the edge. Meaning that they live as APIs in the cloud, but we can also give a subset of it as a container, so you can actually run it in your own infrastructure. So if you want to run, for instance, face recognition model, and you don't want the data to leave your own network, you can just pick up this container, run it in your own container services that you have running on-prem. And the only thing it needs is like every 15 minutes, a connection to the internet so it can send the billing information back to the cloud. So, but for the rest, you can run it completely in detached scenarios. And that is great if you need like speed and all those kind of things. Okay, before we go on, these cognitive services are divided in 4 main regions. So you have the vision services to make your application see, speech to make your application talk and listen to you, language to make your application understand what is being spoken or typed, and knowledge to give your application a brain. And these are like
getting services. So we're going by just like what most humans are naturally doing on their own, which is looking at things. I mean, most humans, and I should put it that way, very, very specifically, they're looking, they're speaking, they're using some sort of language, and then they're exchanging knowledge. So these are things that we could actually kind of glean, because these are basic human outputs.
Exactly.
And the fact that, yeah, and so that's the thing that I always really appreciate about a lot of these modern technologies, is what it's really supposed to be doing for us is making, are these modern, or I should say these standard outputs that we as human beings have, and finding ways to turn them into bigger information, predictive information, or even just analyze what it is.
Exactly. So, but today, we're not going to use these services. We are actually going to build one ourselves. So we're going to create our own API where we can send images to, and which can say, hey, it's a cat, or it is a llama. And for that, we're going to use Azure Machine Learning Studio. And Azure Machine Learning Studio is a fully managed cloud service that enables us to really easily build, deploy, and share our model building process from data up to production and get everything versioned and repeatable. Every machine learning project starts with a question. because machine learning models answer questions. So our question, what we're going to answer is it a llama or is it a cat? And in this case, I know these are alpacas. I learned it in a previous presentation. But for the ease of this presentation, we're going to treat them as llamas.
We don't have to get too completely specific here. We're just kind of, you know, flip of a coin. Did we get a llama? Did we get an alpaca? Who knows? Yeah. They both look the same. But it's fairly obvious that a cat and a llama, they look pretty damn different.
Yeah. But that is exactly one of the points with machine learning. And we are going to tell the computer that the llama and the alpaca is the same thing. So the machine learning algorithm will learn that both of those things are a llama. It has no magic or anything that it will tell me, Hank, that is not a llama, that is an alpaca. It will just believe me that it is an alpaca. So what are we going to use for that? We're going to use Azure Machine Learning, PyTorch, a GPU cluster, and then we're going to deploy it in the cloud. So let's have a look how one of these processes would look like. And we're going to look from a team's perspective. So we have all different disciplines in that team, which we need to actually get our solution up and running. So let's first start with our data scientist. Our data scientist is in charge of figuring out the right data using, for instance, Jupyter Notebooks, using their own version control, using Azure Machine Learning Service to train the model. And then the deliverable of the data scientist is to register the created model in a service called Model Management, which is part of Azure Machine Learning. Then we have the developer. And the developer, she is going to create the software around the model because the model by itself doesn't do anything. So we need to write software, we need to write the API, we need to expose a port, we need to handle the incoming data, check if the data is actually an image and not something else. So our developer is going to write that API and use the model from Model Management in that, and going to build the software in his or her favorite tools, use different version control because there are different life cycles. Use probably a build pipeline to deliver a container. And then we have our operations team that is actually going to deploy that container with the model and with the software, using a deploy pipeline to Azure Kubernetes service.
We all love Kubernetes. Give me some sweet, sweet Kubernetes. I feel like that's one of the biggest things that we've seen in the last few years is how much people want Kubernetes to kind of be part of their whole idea, their whole solution. The fact that they have come up with ways to manage Kubernetes, Azure Kubernetes Service, it's a really great control plane that really helps reduce how much overhead that you need to accomplish in order for you to have a really great working application, whether it's something as complex as a data science process or something like a, let's say, a standard CRUD application or something like that. So glad to see that we're going to talk some Kates, if you will.
Perfect. And we will. And then, of course, we have an API calling, sending Simpsons images in this case, or llama images to our endpoint. So what is Azure Machine Learning Service? It is not just one thing. It is a set of cloud services, like an Azure Container Registry, Azure Machine Learning Service, Blob Storage, a Key Vault. And that set of services you can control with the Python SDK or the Azure CLI. And that set of services enables us to prepare data, train our models, and actually deploy our models. To get started, I've divided it in like three main things. First, we need to make Azure do what we want, prepare our environment. Then we need to actually build our model And that's called experimentation. We can do it over and over and over again. And then when we're happy with our model, we can deploy it. So preparing our environment. We can do that in multiple ways. We can go to the Azure portal, click, click, click. We can go to Visual Studio Code, right click, 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 click. Or we can use the Python SDK to create these environments for us. And
so it's pretty similar to almost everything that accesses the Azure Resource Manager. It's going through that control plane that Azure provides and allowing you to either the portal, the VS Code. I spent some time last week with Brian Benz, and we were playing around with Visual Studio Code and Azure CLI and how those are basically, you can do things one-to-one, if you will. It's just a matter of the interface that you're really feel more comfortable with.
Yes, exactly. But I still do recommend using the Python SDK because you will actually type in code what you're going to create. You can check that into a GitHub repository and everyone can redo your steps. So I always like that. So from now on, we're going to look at code. So the first thing we need is to create a workspace. You can create a workspace. You have to do that one time. And then we write out the configuration file. And then everyone else can connect to that same workspace by calling workspace from config. It will load in the config file, spin up some authentication, and then you have access to that workspace. And if you have your workspace, it looks like this. So you see this environment lives outside of the Microsoft Azure portal. And let's dive into what you actually get. So we're zooming into the most important parts. So we have data sets. Under data sets, we can register our data sets that we're going to use. So we have, in this case, a llama and a cat data set. We will register it here. And every time I have a new version, it gets registered as cats, Hank's cats and dogs of cats and llamas data set, version 1, version 2, version 3. So I can keep track of which data is being used to train my models. On the experiments, we keep track of our training runs. So every time we train our model, it is generating log files, it is generating artifacts, we can find it back under experiments.
Gotcha.
Then when we're done with our experiment and we're happy with the model, we can pick up the model and register that model under model management. And this is a really cool but simple concept. And I always see this model management as like kind of the NuGet repository for models. So if I would be coding C#, I would pull out a package with version 2.0 and use that in my solution. So you can see this the same. You can say, give me Hank's llama model version 2, and you pull it in and you use it.
And for everybody watching, just so you know, check out the link below right here about how to actually create machine learning models. There are, if I'm right, there's a bunch of pre-created ones, Hank. There are ones that are eventually can be created by yourself and uploaded and stored within Azure so that you can always go back to them. And I think a big part of this, you can tell me, is the fact that communities can share models so that they can have these kind of predictive services for other or predictive, you know, information or whatever it is across different data sets if they're just using the same kind of structure of the data, I would imagine. Am I kind of right there?
Yeah, there's data sets you can actually share. Yes.
Great.
So, and then we have endpoints. So we have the endpoints where our deployed models are. So they just get the URL and the specifications on how you can call them. And we have pipeline endpoints. So we're not going to dive into that because that is a whole other talk, but you can create pipelines. And pipelines are steps. It's just a complete workflow, and those workflow consists of all the different steps that are needed to train a model. You publish that workflow, and you can kick it off one of those training workflows by just calling an API endpoint. It is compute, Here we manage all our different types of compute. And then there are data stores where we actually manage the connections to our data. So we were talking about data sets, but data stores hold the connection, like the connection string to your blob storage, the connection string to your SQL server. And so in your code, you only have to reference a data store, and you never have to use credentials in your code, which is pretty cool. So when we have our workspace, we need to create compute. In this case, I'm creating an Azure Machine Learning cluster with standard NC6 machines. And a standard NC6 is the cheapest virtual machine that actually has an NVIDIA GPU in it. So standard NVIDIA compute 6 cores.
Which is important because standard compute, standard CPUs can't really do as many operations, if I'm right. Is that the main reason why you're using GPUs? Kind of like why we use them for video games. It's just the standard CPU just can't output as much data. Am I right?
Yeah. It goes way, way, way faster. But for some problems, a CPU is enough. And for some problems, you want to have GPUs. It really depends on the problem you're trying to solve.
Do you know who, so NVIDIA is the primary one where we have in it. Are there any other real popular chipsets that you know people love aside from NVIDIA to do this work?
No, I only have heard that people use NVIDIA.
Very cool. Yeah. Figure I just ask. I'm curious what other vendors are out there providing these types of services. Very cool.
I actually have no idea. I didn't look at that.
Hey, so if you're watching and you know about other providers of GPUs, let us know. We'd be interested in hearing what you've worked with.
Exactly. And finally, to get started, after the workspace and compute, we need to have storage. So we need to put our data somewhere. So no more slides, and let's go to some code.
Yeah. And so everybody remember, like I was just saying, if you want to leave us some comments and questions while Hank gets our demo ready, go ahead and leave your comments at the bottom. If you're watching on Learn TV, we will get to you, I promise. And also, as a big reminder, while Hank sets everything up for his demo, that poll we're doing, it was coming up shortly. I should say you should watch that poll. It's not coming up. I should just say check out our poll, answer it, because we've got about a half hour left, and I want to find out what you've done and if you've used machine learning so far. So, Hank, let me hand you the reins, and why don't you go ahead and start showing us our little demo. We got about a good half hour for you.
That will be good. So let's go through this demo. We're going to build this model, and for that, we're going to use Jupyter Notebooks. So if you're not familiar with Jupyter Notebooks, this is a really easy way of scripting things. So we have cells. In those cells, you put code, you click run, and it will execute the code, and all these cells share state of your code. So this Jupyter Notebook is loaded now, and let's start and run it. So I always start with putting all my dependencies all the way on top, so I don't have to put them in these other cells, but some people just put them in per cell. So let's run that, and we will see that it will finally print out when it is loaded all the dependencies, which version of the Azure Machine Learning SDK we're using. And this is all Python. So what I've installed is Python and the Azure Machine Learning SDK and Jupyter Notebook support. Here we see we're running the 1.16 version of the Azure ML SDK. So I've already created the workspace. You can see that workspace here. Mm-hmm. And I can connect, just have to say workspace from config. You might wonder what is in that configuration file. The only thing that is in the configuration file is a link to my workspace. That is it. Nothing special is in there. So my workspace is called Cybertron. So we're going to connect to this workspace. I've already set up the compute. we can see the compute here. So this is the place where we can manage compute. So we have four types of compute. We have compute instances. These are used to run our Jupyter notebooks in the cloud.
Virtual machines, essentially.
Yeah, but they just run. Yeah, it are virtual machines, but they have come pre-installed with Jupyter and all the connections to Azure Machine Learning for you. And you can run notebooks on them. You can run them from here. Then we have compute clusters. I have Optimus Prime. This is my GPU-enabled cluster with a standard NC6 machine. That is one node up and running at the moment. And here we have Bumblebee, and that one only consists of standard T3 V2 machines. And
so our two Autobots are ready to kind of get started with these different Jupyter notebooks that you're going to start running.
Yes. So we are going to use our Optimus Prime cluster because we will need the GPU because we don't want to wait.
Mm-hmm.
And here we can see the details of the cluster. Here we see which GPU unit it is using, my configuration. So there is always one node up and running, and it can scale up to a maximum of four nodes. You can set this to zero, and then it will automatically shut down, and it will not bill your credit card anymore. You can run these securely in your own virtual networks, and you can choose your region.
So everything here is the same payment model of pay as you go, as you use with Azure, correct?
Yes, absolutely. This is just being built exactly the same as if you would create a standard Linux machine.
And so here's a question, though. If you leave this idle, it's going to continue to cost you money, am I right? So if you build one of these and just say, oh, you know, I'll get to it later, and later ends up being 2 weeks, you're still going to pay for 2 weeks worth of use on that VM.
Yes. So what you want to do is set this minimum nodes to zero. When you submit your job, it will automatically spin up one of these machines. But for this demo, we don't want to wait like 5 minutes for a machine to be provisioned for us. But if you do this in your work scenario, you basically want to do this.
Mm-hmm.
Put it to zero and maybe put the idle seconds a little bit higher than this.
So especially if you're using it for a demo, just be certain, because you don't want to take home a big bill just for or use up your whole $200 credit if you got something like this URL. You don't want to use it all up in one big swoop when you have an opportunity to spread it all around by just making sure your instances are disabled.
Yeah, because this machine is around 700 euros a month.
Mm-hmm.
If you have a 24/7 on. And I've never let it on for like a week or two.
Then you're definitely getting it right, Hank.
You never forget afterwards to put them off. So we have our compute. We will dive into the other types of compute a little bit later because that is for the deployment part. So we will go here. We will connect. We will connect to our default data storage, so the blob storage that's been created, and then we will connect to our experiment Lemmas VS Cats with PyTorch.
And if you're watching and you'd like to do the demo that Hank is working on, we've got that information in the chat. Let me go ahead and put it up for you here. Here's today's demo code. It's right there on GitHub.
Cool. So we need to have data. The data is here on my machine. We can specify where it is. We can upload it. We can create a data set from it. We say data set from files, tell it where the data is. Then we register that data set. And then later on, we can connect to the data set. So under datasets, you'll find my different datasets. So here we have the Llama VS Cats one. We'll load, it will tell us how many files are in there, which version it is when it is created. Tells us how we can consume this dataset using Python code. And we can actually explore it. So we will see hopefully soon. Here, there's a cat. And here is a llama.
So this is all your data that you're training everything on. It's just cats
Yes.
and llamas.
Good llamas and alpacas. Yes. So we
We
can
don't want to
preview
forget
it.
the alpacas. We don't want alpaca erasure here. We want to make sure that they are well represented.
Absolutely. So here we can check which data is in. So it is there. So now the training of the model comes. I will skip the slides and we will go straight into it because I want to show you a running model before the 40 hours finished. So this is the training script. And you might wonder where did Hank get that training script? So I went to the PyTorch website and I went to this example of transfer learning for computer vision tutorial. I picked that script up and just pasted it here in as my training script. And I've added a few things. Because we're going to submit this script to our cluster, it needs to know where our data is, and it needs to be aware of that it is actually how it is running. I added some extra logging. So here, every training round we log, like, hey, the accuracy is this, the loss is this. And then finally, I'm saving the output, the model, which is actually just this file. I'm saving that to the outputs folder together with our labels, llama, cat. And everything you save in the output folder will be automatically copied and versioned. So let's do that. So now we have a training script in this folder, training scripts, train.py, still on my machine. So we need to have an environment where it is going to run in. So you can use curated environments that are environments maintained and created by the lovely folks of the Azure Machine Learning Service. Or you can create and set up your own environment if you need very specific packages. But this is a straightforward PyTorch model. So I'm picking this environment, Azure Machine Learning environment with PyTorch version 1.6, optimized for my GPU. I get that environment, I clone it, and I can use it. So then next, now I have a script, an environment, I'm going to specify how this script has to run. So I'll specify where it can actually find my data set. So this is the data set that we have created on top. We say llama cat data set. Take it as a named input, llama vs cat. You can just put a name and then mount it. So by doing this, now it automatically knows. And what it does is it mounts that folder where my data is as a virtual directory in my Linux. So my training script can just look in slash temp slash slash mount slash llama vs cats and access the data. I tell it where it can find my training script. I tell it where to run, on which cluster it has to run, which environment it has to use, and I give it the incoming arguments. Let's run that and then submit that experiment of submit that script configuration to my cluster.
Gotcha. So you're writing instructions and then you're putting it in the automation to send the instructions up.
Yes.
Am
So
I kind of
now it
right
is
there?
submitted. Yes. So now what it is doing, it is spinning up this Docker container for me with all these things installed. It is mounting my data folder. It is copying over everything in my training scripts directory. And it is starting up train.py when it is ready. So actually, it has already done that now. It is that fast. So here we see it is running. It's busy for 36 seconds. And here we can actually see exactly what is going on. Here you can
And
see
so
that it has mounted my data set.
that's inside the container right now that's running,
Yes.
or that's at least getting configured and then grabbing your script, correct?
Yes. So
Gotcha.
it is running, and here we can switch to the driver's log. And here we see it is already running my script. So it is downloaded the base model, and now it is starting to run, do the training runs. And because it is going to do 12 training rounds, so it improves itself, we will see here the accuracy and the loss. So these four graphs are being generated by these two lines I've added in my code. Just two lines. And the cool thing now is that all of this is not only available in my notebook, it is also available in under my experiment here. So the latest run is 6. That is what we're doing now. Here we see it is running. Here we see the accuracy, the loss, all the digits. We can go to the metrics. Here we see the graphs being generated. We have here the snapshot of my training script. So everyone can read.
And that's just Python, if I'm right.
Yeah. This is just Python. Yeah.
Very, very cool.
And the handy thing and why it is important is now this model is delivered. And like 6-7 months later, the model is like nobody, the one that is created this model left. You can just go here and figure out, okay, so this is the code he or she actually used to create this model. And here is the bug. Let's fix it. Instead of, oh, where is the laptop from someone that has created this? Here we can dive into all the logging and read what is going on. So there is one slide I would like to show for this.
Please
to illustrate a little bit better what went on under the hood. So we have here, that is this slide. So we are in our Jupyter notebook running on my machine. And when I set submit, it's sent everything over to this experiment, snapshotted my folder. Then it started creating this Docker image according to my specifications and deployed that Docker container to my compute target. It mounted my data stores and then launched my training script. And while my training script was running, it actually sending all the information it generates back to my experiment. And then because I'm running a widget on my Azure notebook, I can connect to my experiment and get the data. And then it copies over when it is done. It copies over everything in the outputs folder back to the experiment. So hopefully we will see that. Now when we go back, the model is still running. So a cool thing about Azure Machine Learning Studio also is, while we wait for the model to finish, is that you can compare it with the other runs of the same model. So maybe I tweaked a little bit in my model, maybe I used some different data. So here we can actually compare those different runs and graphs against each other. Now, we see that run 6 is completed.
Mm-hmm.
So here we see done. So what it now delivered us is, if we go here to output and logs, we see that it is at our labels, cat and llama, and our model. And you don't want to click on this.
Because that's probably some huge, huge file, correct?
Yes, with a lot of zeros and things in it. So here we have...
So it's a binary file. Specifically, correct?
I basically think so. I don't want to click on it again.
So we got about 12 minutes left. Everybody, yes. please go ahead. Put in some questions if you have. We definitely want to hear from you.
So we can do it within those 12 minutes to actually have it up and running. So the next thing we need to do is register our model. So we're going to register it as under the name Llama or Cat PyTorch. And we're going to tag it with Azure Fun Bytes. Can give it a description. And here we tell it, if you're going to run this model, this is our preferred resource configuration. Use one CPU and at least 2 GB of memory.
Okay.
You don't have to, but this is the recommendation. So let's register it. So now our Llama or Cat PyTorch model is registered with number 5. If we go here and we go to model management, you'll see our model here, which is actually tagged with Azure Fun Bytes. And from here, we can go back to which experiment it is created in and which run. So So in the run, we can go here, we see which compute target it was, and we can go back to the data set. So from the model, we can go back to the log files to the data. So that is really handy. So let's download the model and actually run some testing data through it to see if this model is actually doing something.
Let's do it.
Let's run the script. And we pick every image in the directory data llama svercat test. We loop through that and run it all through the model. So we see it's 100% sure that this is a cat, llama. So our model is doing what it is supposed to do, differentiate between those two classes. So now it is time. We have our model registered, we have a script, we have tested it to deploy our model. And for that, we need to create a scoring script. So what does this scoring script do? It loads the model. It's loading in models takes time. And then on every request, gets the image, prepares the image, pre-processes the image, runs it through the model, and returns the result. So let's generate the score.py script. And then we need to create an environment where this scoring script can run in. So this is exactly the same as how you would create this, this environment where you're training in. Only this environment doesn't need as much as your training environment. So we can create an environment here by saying the llama svercat inference environment, install these packages, and that's it. We have to tell it how to do it again. Use this scoring script on this environment. And now we can actually deploy this configuration to an Azure Container instance or to an Azure Kubernetes service. So what we first have to do is to create a... let me see if we have done it right. We have the model. We have the inference config. So yes. So we can connect to my linked Azure Kubernetes service, which I still have to change. Mm-hmm. How you spell it. We can find it under compute. So compute inference clusters. So here is my Kubernetes class service cluster Exodus. You can create a Kubernetes service easily from here. Mm-hmm. Just say create, select the location. Let's do it. Then it will tell us I'm not allowed to do that.
Not be in Australia, may not be available. And so I think it always comes down to where there's available compute too.
Exactly. So Western Europe is always the same guess for me. You select how many, what you want, next, and it will deploy this the service, and it will deploy a mm-hmm. bunch of helper containers where you're going to deploy your container into it. So I've done that. And my service is called Exodus and actually running in my Kubernetes cluster called Exodus and a lot of numbers here. Can refresh and detach it. And here I can go to the cluster and actually find all the information you would find with a regular Kubernetes cluster. So it is exactly sure. The same thing.
So pods, all that kind of stuff, you'll get all that information
there. Yes, absolutely. So I'm connecting to my AKS compute, create my deployment configuration, 1 GPU, 2 GB of memory. Let's call this Azure Fun Bytes deployment. It's the model, inference config, deployment config, target. And if it already exists, overwrite it. So let's do that. And it should take like up to 20, 30 seconds, mm-hmm. hopefully. Should not take longer than 10 minutes. That's hopeful. And it is deploying now. So you can find these deployments back. Oh, it here. It has nice notifications. That's new. We can find this back under endpoints. Here we see that our deployment is already here. You can click it. It is still... is completed. Ooh, these notifications
there we go.
Are nice. Our deployment status healthy on our compute target. This is the model that is deployed. So even from the deployment, we can go back to the model, to the training round, to the experiment, to the data. We can see even with git commit was used to create this this model. And here we see the endpoint.
Gotcha.
This enabled. There is a Swagger URL automatically for you. There is the GPU and memory. Auto scale is how many replicas, min and max, when it has to scale. It's all done out of the box for you. Here it will tell you how to test it, and here how to actually consume it. And these are the keys to do that. So what we are going to do now is go to our Jupyter notebook and start testing it. So we can print out here the endpoint and the keys. I have here a text file with all the testing images, and we're just going to post it to the endpoint. And there is an easy helper method that will take care of all the security for us. And why is it not working? Because
we're doing it live, that's why.
Okay, but it is actually working because it is just...
Oh,
because
there you get your output. So let's see. So it's accurately told us what's what.
Yes, so it should have been doing exactly the same as the other model, of course, because we're sending the same images to it. Mm-hmm. So that is done the same. Llamas, llama, cat. Here we are. So now we have our model running in Azure Kubernetes.
Very cool.
In a pod. Let me see if I have always one final slide. We still have a few minutes left.
Yeah, we got about 3 minutes.
Then we can do a quick recap out of that. Went to the demo. So what we have seen is we have starting with preparing our environment, setting up a workspace, compute and storage. Then we started experimenting with our data, created an experiment, trained our model, registered our model. Then we picked our model up, created a deployment, and deployed our model. And if you want to do that yourself, you can go to this link.
Very, very cool, Hank. Thank you so much. And so before we get ready to say goodbye, why don't we take a look at our poll? And it looks like, you know, most of our viewers really want to start using. And I think that we've given them some really good tools to start using machine learning. And so you can check out this link here, or the other one that I think is really, really helpful is heading over to Microsoft Learn. And I know that there's lots of great information that you can start learning immediately and gaming, it's gamified, so you get points and all sorts of neat stuff. So Hank, we're just down to the wire here, and I wanted to say thank you so much for being part of this. I know you do you did like an ML show yesterday with Amy?
Yes, that was this morning actually for us.
This morning.
It is based it's focused on the European time zone. So it was our morning coffee show. So that was yesterday night for you, I think.
Absolutely.
Yes. And in that
very early for me. But absolutely. But I know you're doing that. So I believe that's on the Microsoft Developer YouTube. Am I right?
Yes, it should be
very
there.
Cool. Yep. So if you'd like to learn even more, you know, Hank's got tons and tons of content all over. If you look him up by his Twitter, I'm sure you can go and find everything. Plus, obviously, we shared it earlier, the today's demo. It's right here. If you'd like to do this, go for it. So anyway, Hank, thank you so much again. And I really appreciate your time. I know you're it's a little late for you right now. And so we're going to make sure we leave so you can get your evening into the full relaxation mode.
Thank you.
No problem.
Thanks for having me.
You're welcome. Thank you so much, Hank. Hey, we're going to say goodbye to you. Thank you so much, everybody, for watching. We're going to give you that big, big wave goodbye. Thanks again. We will see you next week here Thursday. I think we're doing identity. Very, very cool. So we'll catch you next time here on Azure Fun Bytes.